What makes a culture? What defines one culture versus another? How do cultures change? Or perhaps the better question is, how does a culture resist change? Merriam-Webster defines culture as the customary beliefs, social forms, and material traits of a racial, religious, or social group. Christina De Rossi, an anthropologist with Barnett and Southgate College in London, states that culture encompasses religion, food, what we wear, how we wear it, our language, marriage, music, what we believe is right or wrong, how we sit at the table, how we greet visitors, how we behave with loved ones, and a million other things. Now, the big question related to all that is, what about our Western culture? You see, our Western culture is becoming what is defined as a, quote, cancel culture, unquote. What does that mean? Well, it's a culture based on individuals telling each other what is right or wrong, trying to define what religion is best or should be, what language to use, how marriage should look, how music should resonate with the culture, and an array of other things for the culture. In an odd way, cancel culture is a culture of forcing culture on the culture. Did you catch that? But what we're all finding out in this cancel culture is that it's complex, and culture is powerful, and culture is not easily altered or broken. That is, unless a culture can learn to act with grace and sacrifice. Grace and sacrifice throughout history can change a culture. It changes people. Today, in our final week of The Good Samaritan, we'll look at the cultural cost of loving our neighbor. What does it look like to have a culture, to be an individual in a culture of loving our neighbor and to laying down our wants and needs to serve others? That sometimes sacrifice is required of us to go against an established culture in order to help someone in need, in order to give them grace, in order to sacrifice for them. There's a cost. What does it look like? We can change culture if we show grace and sacrifice. Today is our last week in our series, The Good Samaritan, the cost of loving your neighbor, the cost of loving my neighbor, our neighbors. Now, this is one of the most popular parables, both inside and outside the church. Almost everyone in Western culture kind of knows or has an idea of the Good Samaritan. We've been looking at the financial cost. We looked at the physical cost, the time and energy. Last week, we looked at the social cost. And today, we're going to look at the cultural cost of loving your neighbor. Now, if you missed any of these episodes, it's important that you go back and watch previous messages so that you're all caught up, because we're going to be referring back. You can do that at mountainviewwhitehorse.ca/watch. That's mountainviewwhitehorse.ca/watch. But if you're all caught up, we're going to jump right back in to our parable in Luke 10. Go to Luke 10, and we're going to start off once again with this lawyer that approaches Jesus with questions. In Luke 10, verses 25 and 29, we see these two questions. Verse 25, it says, "And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' And then in verse 29, we see as a follow-up question that says, and the verse says, but he, the lawyer, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? This idea that in the law, in the commandments, there's this idea, the very foundational commandments are that we would love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. But the big debate is, who's considered my neighbor? This lawyer is trying to get away with excluding certain people. And Jesus is going to come right at that and blow the whole thing out of the water, which is why Jesus was gaining popularity at this time anyway. His teaching was radical. It pushed against culture, and we're going to see it here. But first, let's think about what this culture is. This is actually a culture of law, a culture of religious law. And this lawyer, keep in mind, we talked about it before, this is a keeper of the Mosaic law, the first five books of the Bible. And we're going to be looking at a few of the laws and commandments today in today's message. But he's a keeper of it. And if you think about first century Jewish culture, the Mosaic law, the Torah, the Pentateuch, it is intertwined in every part of culture. There are rules and laws and commandments that God gave to his people that really cover every aspect of life. So if you think about it, we don't really have a direct comparison in today's culture. But if you can imagine religious law, everyone's kind of in agreement, and it kind of governs in and intertwines into everything. So if we understand that, this lawyer is not just a lawyer in what we would perceive a lawyer as, but a religious lawyer, a cultural lawyer, that he's keeping culture on track with religious statutes and commandments that God gave. And there are 613 commandments and subsequent laws that people needed to adhere to and be followed. And this lawyer is the guy that's keeping things in check. He's the authority figure in this culture of religious law. But there's another piece to first century that's not specifically mentioned in this passage that we need to remember. And it's the Roman occupation. The Roman Empire was a foreign military law. They had military precision in everything they did. They would sweep through and conquer countries like it was nothing at this time. And so now try to think about this crowd, this Jewish crowd that Jesus is speaking to, and this lawyer that he's trying to answer his questions and kind of get through his tests. This is a culture of religious law that has been conquered and is now being occupied by a foreign military law. And the Roman Empire brought all sorts of different religious gods and beliefs. And even Caesar, the head of the Roman Empire, placed himself as a deity, as a god. So there is culture right now is in a huge conflict. And if we think about this, again, imagine this lawyer. He's already having a tough job. He's trying to keep this religious law in their culture, sustain the culture. And there's this Roman occupation that's always pushing against it. And so he's got that going on. Maybe, let's give him some credit, maybe he's ultra sensitive to any teacher that might be shifting things or changing things. And there's this careful dance that the Jewish leaders are having to do and the authorities with the Roman Empire and who rules what and how far does each authority go. And it's tenuous. And speaking of which, on Good Friday, this Friday, we're going to actually read about this awkward, convoluted dance that the Jewish authorities in their religious law and the Roman authorities in their military law, this dance that happens is quite convoluted in order to get Jesus crucified and to arrest him and kill him and get rid of him. It's a strange culture, one that would be totally foreign to us. We're just not familiar with it. But if we can go back in time and think about this, we can get an understanding of how this parable might have landed. Now, what we know about a culture of law, if we look throughout history, if law becomes the primary keeper of everything, there is always a temptation with fallen humanity that control and hypocrisy is nearby. And we get a sense with this lawyer trying to justify himself. Now, a caveat, maybe you're thinking, wait a second, Jeremy, are you saying that God's Mosaic law, that the Old Testament is not valuable or it's not worth it or it's not important? That's not what I'm saying. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that Jesus is using this parable to highlight sin and that even God's law can be corrupted by human beings. We can take good things that God gives us and we can corrupt them in our culture and use them for control and eventual hypocrisy. And let's face it, this still happens today. Many people, unfortunately, use the Bible to control others or to control it for their own benefit, which is hypocrisy. And many outside the church look at that and struggle being a part of a Christian community, a church community. The hypocrisy is a big barrier. And humans are the same. Hypocrisy was happening in Jesus' day, just like it was in ours, if not more, because these legal authorities had so much power over the people. This was culture. Now, we've established this culture of law, but now let's walk through our parable. Jesus, remember, as this man is half dead on the roadside, two people come forward and onto the path, but pass by on the other side, a priest and a Levite. Let's read about that again, verses 31 and 32. Jesus says, "Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side." Now, in a culture of law where the Torah, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible and the subsequent scriptures, when they rule, when they are intertwined into culture, how does that culture view priests and Levites? Well, we can read about that. We're actually going to go to the law. We're going to do a little bit of Bible college study. So if you don't have a print version of the Bible, open up a Bible app and we're going to go to Numbers. So Numbers is way back in the front of your Bible. And we're going to go to Numbers 8 and we're going to look, what does the law say? What would people have understood about priests and Levites? And when we get to Numbers 8, we're going to go to verse 19. Verse 19 states, "And I have given the Levites as a gift to Aaron and his sons from among the people of Israel to do the service for the people of Israel at the tent of meeting and to make atonement for the people of Israel, that there may be no plague among the people of Israel when the people of Israel come near the sanctuary." So it's very interesting that Levites, priests and Levites, in a culture of law, in a culture of Mosaic law, they are a gift to culture from God. They are set apart by God. They're asked to do or set aside to do the spiritual work for the people. We see some important things here, that they make atonement for the people. And maybe you're wondering, why would a culture accept, or how would they view a priest and a Levite walking past a half-dead man? Because in our culture, if a pastor or a priest kind of walk past a half-dead man, the culture would look at that and say, come on, you should be helping him. What kind of excuse or what would the law state about these two men that pass by? Do they have an excuse? Do they have a right in this culture? Well, we find out that they do maybe have a partial right or an excuse maybe. And if we go to same thing in, if you're in Numbers, you're going to go forward a bit Leviticus, which is right before Numbers, and you're going to go to Leviticus 21. Leviticus 21, again, this is the in the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. And Leviticus 21, verses 1 to 3, we read this. "And the Lord said to Moses, speak to the priests, the son of Aaron, and say to them, no one shall make himself unclean for the dead among his people, except for his closest relatives, his mother, his father, his son, his daughter, his brother, or his virgin sister." Okay, now let's scroll back to Numbers. Keep that in mind. And we're going to scroll back to Numbers, go back towards the back of your Bible, back to where we were. We're going to go to Numbers 19. Numbers 19 again, looking at the law and laws concerning priests and Levites. In verse 11 to 13, check this out. It says, "Whoever touches the dead body of any person shall be unclean 7 days. He shall cleanse himself with the water on the third day and on the seventh day, and so be clean. But if he does not cleanse himself on the third day and on the seventh day, he will not become clean. Whoever touches a dead person, the body of anyone who has died, and does not cleanse himself, defiles the tabernacle of the Lord, and that person shall be cut off from Israel." This is harsh, right? "Because the water for impurity was not thrown on him, he shall be unclean. His uncleanliness is still on him." So for normal people, touching a dead body is not a good thing. But if you can imagine, for the spiritual leaders, the religious elite in that culture, priests and Levites, them to touch a dead body, this is serious business. This is not good. It prevents them from doing spiritual work. It's quite a inconvenience, right? Unless it's your family, then that needs to happen. And there's grace for that, I think, even in that culture of law with their own family. So they don't know this guy on the road. So maybe, just maybe, the culture would say, yeah, but come on, they're priests and Levites. What if the guy was dead? Like, he was half dead. And some might say, or you might say, well, couldn't he have checked on him? Couldn't he have maybe seen if he was really dead? Well, they don't want to go near him, right? This uncleanliness. Remember, this is a culture of law. And so they don't want to be seen bending over a dead body. There's a lot of reasons here. But where the crowd would have given maybe a little grace or a little understanding for these Levites and priests, there's also an edginess to Jesus' story and an offensiveness, because Jesus could have just said another person. And they would realize that Jesus actually chose a priest and a Levite on purpose. One author puts it this way: perhaps he had concluded that the man was already dead, the priest, and did not want to risk ceremonial defilement. Likewise, a Levite, one who assisted priests in the affairs of their ministry, passed by the man. Depicting these religious authorities as callous and unfeeling would no doubt have scandalized the audience. They would have bristled at the notion that these respected authorities could be so unsympathetic. We see here the tension in the culture. These are two people that maybe would have had an excuse, but by Jesus including them in a fictitious story, he's actually bringing to light this cultural excuse and this culture of law, and he's about to introduce something that's going to cause them to think a little deeper. So we get to the Samaritan again. Luke 10, 33 and 34. Jesus says, "But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him, bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him." We have two characters, very in a culture of law, legal characters or godly spiritual people. They pass by. And then we have this Samaritan. These are crazy opposites, not just enemies. These are like total cultural boundaries on two sides, the most highly favored and the most rejected. This is what Jesus has done here. Well, this is actually where it gets really complicated, because maybe you didn't know, but the Samaritans weren't totally abstract or against this culture of law. In fact, they actually kept the Torah or the Pentateuch, with a little bit of a caveat here. You see, the Jews had their Torah or their Pentateuch, and the Samaritans had a version of it. So imagine this for a moment. You have a religious culture, okay, a culture of law, but not only do you have these two people groups that we've learned all about, the financial and racial and social divides between them, now you have two people who follow the Torah, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, the law, but there's variations between the two. You can imagine this gets tenuous. One writer said it this way: "There are several competing accounts of the Samaritan Pentateuch's origin in early history. Samaritan tradition holds that the Samaritan Pentateuch is the genuine version of the Torah, faithfully preserved through the centuries by the Samaritans and traceable all the way back to Abisha, the great-grandson of Aaron, brother of Moses. These claims are difficult for modern historical scholarship to confirm or deny. Considering the comparison of these two texts, one writer says this: the critical apparatus accompanying the London Polyglot's publication of the Samaritan Pentateuch lists 6,000 instances where the Samaritan differs from the Masoretic text. The Septuagint, which is where a lot of our Bible translation comes from, agrees with the Samaritan in approximately 1,900 of the 6,000 variations from the Masoretic text. Many of these agreements reflect inconsequential grammatical details, but some are significant. So now, here's the thing. We have a culture of religious law occupying military law. We always got to keep that in the background. You have opposing enemies, race, culture, social, all these things. And now you have the core texts, the Torah, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, which intertwine all cultures. Now there's over 6,000 variations. Now, some of them grammatical, but some are different. Some of the specific ones are like where worship should happen. And if you have some spare time, you can dive deep into the differences between these two Torahs. But this divides things, right? Even further. So now we look, let's look at the law though. Let's look at some more of the law. Let's go back and read some of what they would have known. Let's go back to Leviticus. Because there's an important text in Leviticus that really is at the bottom of all this controversy and these questions in this parable. And it's Leviticus 19, 17, and 18, something that appears in the Samaritan as well as the Jewish Torah Pentateuch. These verses, verses 17 and 18 of Leviticus 19. It states, "You shall not hate your brother in your heart, but you shall reason frankly with your neighbor, lest you incur sin because of him. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." Okay, but there's key words here. Some key words that I want you to look at. Your brother was in that text. We also read your neighbor. We also read your own people. And this is the key, right? This lawyer, this Jewish lawyer, he wants to say, well, my brother is actually of my race and my creed and following my version of the Torah and Pentateuch. My neighbor is also in that category. And my own people are, again, racially, culturally, the law that we follow. He would have never thought about and never wanted to think about that a Samaritan, different race, and even having a different Torah, a different cultural law, that doesn't apply. This text, this piece of Torah, this piece of God's law, surely it doesn't include Samaritans. And to be honest, maybe for the Samaritan, most Samaritans probably felt the same way. They felt that it was their law, their Torah, their culture, and those people are excluded. Again, we've talked about it all month, that these were terrible enemies. There was conflict and divide. But what does Jesus do here? If we go back to Luke 10, what does Jesus do? By choosing the Samaritan, what he does for this crowd of Jewish people is he makes a choice to make the heretic the hero. I want to say that again. Jesus turns the heretic into the hero. The one who doesn't follow the real law, the subculture religious person. The less than, as we've talked about all month. Jesus, in a twist in the story, makes him to be the one to follow the law to the deepest level. That to the Samaritan, all people are his brother. All people are his neighbor. All people are his people. This is what Jesus is painting into this culture. It is so extremely countercultural. How would have people heard this? What would they have thought of what Jesus just said? Well, Jesus is doing something bigger. He's sending a deeper message. You see, Jesus brings grace into a culture of law. I want to say this again. Jesus is bringing grace, a concept of grace, which that culture needed so desperately. And it was God's plan and God's timing, the fulfillment of the law in Jesus to bring about truth and grace. He's bringing grace into this culture of religious law, living under military law. And now we start to see why these lawyers and scribes and Pharisees and priests hated Jesus. Now we can see and it starts to unveil why they sought to kill him. Why this Friday we're going to fully unpack what took place, why they tried so hard to conspire, to manipulate, to kill Jesus. Because remember we talked about a culture of law can turn into a culture of control and hypocrisy. And when you have law and rules and control and someone brings grace into it, really messes things up. Jesus was scandalous. He turned everything upside down for them. But now we need to remember the original question, right? We've done it all month. We can't leave this parable without knowing and understanding that Jesus is talking about a bigger thing, a deeper thing that applies to you and I. The original question, verse 25, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? You see, this choice in this story, this parable of choosing to bring about a culture of grace into a culture of law speaks to what Jesus brings to each one of us. You see, I think all of us, if we're honest with ourselves, we're always trying to follow the rules. If I pray more, if I read more, if I follow this rule, if I do this, if I don't do this, if I can just get enough of those commandments down, if I can just follow everything to the T, then I'll be good. Then God will accept me and then everything will be fine. But the whole story of the gospel, the fact that there's a New Testament fulfilling the Old Testament, the fact that God sent Jesus, what the law shows us is that there's no amount of work we can do. There is no amount of rules we can follow. We just can never attain the perfection that only Jesus can bring. The grace and sacrifice of Jesus, the cost that he bared in that culture and continues to bear for us in our culture, that blows any rule, any law, any commandment, any following of a set of checklist points. This is a pointer to the new covenant. The Old Testament and the Old Covenant of following the laws and sacrificing animals and the priests and the Levites staying, helping everyone stay in good standing so that if we could just keep this culture of law taking place and if we could just maintain the sacrifices, then maybe we'd stay in good standing with God. But what we see in the Old Testament that we highlighted last week in a major way is that the people of God, like all people, fall away and fall away and fall away. And they get back up and they try and then they fall away. That there was no amount of sacrifice until Jesus. And so Jesus brings about a new covenant. And what about for you and I? Why is this important? Why is this cultural component, this last piece, so important to you and I? We need grace. Our culture needs grace. Your neighbor, your coworker, your families, your friends, the strangers you walk past need grace. They deeply desire and yearn for grace. And like we talked about in the introduction, this cancel culture, if there's one thing cancel culture will not give us on either end of the argument is grace. One group telling certain people that you can't do certain things or highlight certain things, and the other group pushing back and saying, yes, I can, it's my right to, and all. Any spectrum, whatever it is, the one thing that's missing is grace. No one is showing grace and listening and talking and not getting offended. How desperately we need grace. How desperately maybe you need grace. How desperately, I'm telling you right now, I need grace. That is probably something I crave more than anything else in this moment of my life. In verse 16 and 17 of John 1, he writes this: "For from his fullness," the fullness of Jesus, "for from his fullness, we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth come through Jesus Christ." For the law was given through Moses. And it was a good thing for a certain time, but it wasn't fulfilled. But then Jesus comes, fulfills the law, brings grace and truth. We've been given grace upon grace. Even when we fall short, even when we mess up, and we're trying so hard and we still just don't meet the mark, there is grace upon grace. What would it look like if Mountain View Church in this city, in this territory, in this time, what would it look like if we were a people marked for grace upon grace? Where no matter what was going on, that we gave people second chances, third chances, fourth chances. What would it look like? If you need grace today, Jesus is the author of it. He's the one that brings truth and grace. You can trust in that. And right now I'm going to pray, and then we're going to move into communion, which is actually the remembrance of the bringing in of this new covenant. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But right now, it's time for us to ask Jesus for his grace. And so no matter where you're at in your journey, if for the first time you're hearing this and you realize, I need Jesus. In this cancel culture, I got nowhere to go. I got nothing to point me forward. I need Jesus. You can choose him today. But maybe for you, you're a Christian, you're a follower of Jesus, and you've got sidelined by this culture. Of everyone telling you what to do and you feeling a pull to start telling other people what to do, we can repent. We can ask God's forgiveness through Jesus, and we can get that welling up of that grace-filled heart once again. We can become a people of second chances like Jesus calls us to. We can be that people that looks at all people as my brother, my people, my neighbor, and we treat them all the same. If you want that grace today, let's pray. Dear Father, I need your grace. No matter how hard I try, I can't seem to do enough. I can't seem to work hard enough. I can't seem to try hard enough. I continue to mess up and do things I don't want to do and not do things that I want to do. I need the grace you offer through your son, Jesus. I am a sinner, and I repent of my sin, and I ask for a new heart full of the grace of Jesus. Today, I choose to follow the example you set through your son, Jesus. Send your Holy Spirit into my life. Convict me. Change me from the inside out. May I be a light to this world. May I be grace to this world. May I show love and compassion and mercy like the Good Samaritan, even to those that hate me. Empower me to do that. I pray that Mountain View Church would be a people of grace, that we would be patient with each other, that we would be forgiving, that we would give each other second, third, and fourth chances, that we would give each other fresh starts, and that most of all, we might be compelled by your mission of the gospel, and that we would be able to look into our city and see people who need the grace that we have, that amazing grace. It's in the name of Jesus I pray and ask all of this. Amen. All right, you can stop the video if you're gathering at home, or and go get the communion elements, bread, crackers, whatever you have, or some wine, grape juice, whatever you got, and pull them together with your little group there or whoever you're with. And we're going to take communion in just a minute here. Okay, now let's take some time to take communion together, no matter where you're at. Today, since this month we've been going through Luke, we're actually going to look at the account of communion, the Last Supper, in the Gospel of Luke, which isn't one that we normally use. It's not often used, and it's worded a little different. But the key components are definitely there, which is what's most important. And so you can turn with me, if you have your Bible or your Bible app open, to Luke 22. I am going to read the kind of first section that Luke writes. Then I'm going to pray for the bread, and then I'll read the bread component to take the bread or cracker, and we'll take the bread. And then I'll read the cup or the wine, the juice component, and then we'll take the wine. And I'll pray in between those. Luke writes, "And when the hour came, he reclined at table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, 'I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God.' And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, 'Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.'" Dear Father, as we take the bread, I just pray that we would remember and recognize this represents the body of your Son, Jesus. Jesus, help us think about and remember the sacrifice you made for us, that it was out of that love and that grace that you showed us that we would not take the punishment. Though difficult, help us see you on the cross, understanding why you suffered. In your name I pray, amen. You can take the bread or cracker. In verse 19 it says, "And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Dear Father, now we move to the cup, which is important for this message. We understand that this cup is representation of your Son's blood, which is the new covenant, the new sacrifice, the ultimate sacrifice. The old covenant, the Old Testament, constantly trying to atone for their sins through animal sacrifice, but it was never enough. And you loved us enough to send your Son. Jesus, you chose to follow the Father's will, go to the cross, shed your blood. That atoning blood, a final sacrifice for all people, every race, every culture, every age throughout time. 2,000 years ago, and yet it is so meaningful even now for us in this moment. May we understand, may your Spirit convict us of what that blood means and how precious, how important it is that it showed your truth and grace, your love and adoration for us, that we might be welcomed into the kingdom of God through this sacrifice. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Verse 20, "And likewise, the cup after they had eaten, saying, 'This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood.'" Thank you so much for tracking with us on this Good Samaritan journey. I am sure that Luke 10 is a chapter that you will never forget. You heard it so many times. You've studied it so in depth. I'd love to hear back if this study of the Good Samaritan, if it impacted you, or if you had an extra question or a comment, please leave it in the stream below or send me a message. I really appreciate any feedback that we can get when we do an in-depth study on this. Any biblical content we have, we just want to hear from you. So it'd be great. It helps me be a better Bible teacher, a better pastor. So I appreciate that. But we're not done for today. We still have our discussion groups. So wherever you're at, even if you're online, you can comment below. I have two questions for you related to today's final Good Samaritan study. First, consider, talk about, think about, reflect on our Western cancel culture. Who needs the most grace right now? As you think about cancel culture sweeping across the West, the anger, the division, the discord, we definitely see it on social media. As you look at that, who needs grace most? Now, maybe you're going to say, well, we all need grace. It's true. But maybe ask God to reveal a certain person or people group that needs grace more than others. And once you have that and you've discussed that, how will you and your household show grace to those individuals this week? That people group, those people that the Lord has led you, hey, they need some grace, extra grace this week. How are you going to show it? How can you bless them? Again, with the ultimate goal that we don't just study the Bible, we don't just study the gospel, we don't just study Jesus' life and meet together as a church and look at content and sing and pray. We don't just do all this for nothing. We're also on a mission that Jesus has given us, that we need to go out into the world and we need to tell others. That is the greatest way we can be gracious to them, is tell them the truth of Jesus Christ. But as we're doing that, we can also do kind things for them. Show them love, mercy, and compassion. Who needs it? Who needs grace this week in your life? Let's, as a church, get in the community and do that. Thank you so much. This Friday, remember, we have a Good Friday service. Make sure you register if you're coming to a physical gathering. Digital gatherings will be posted on the website at mountainviewwhitehorse.ca/Good Friday. And then on Sunday, the big event, Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, we're going to have a bunch of physical gatherings. We're going to have an egg hunt for kids and families. It's going to be amazing. Make sure you register or check out mountainviewwhitehorse.ca/Easter for all the details. Thank you so much.